When Yosef reveals himself to his brothers, it's about the most dramatic scene ever. And they are thunderstruck. They're dumbfounded. They can't say a word. He says, come closer. I'm Yosef, whom you sold to Egypt. And at this point, they're probably thinking, we are in big trouble. Because he is the ruler of this country now, and we are his prisoners. And instead he says, don't be distressed. Don't worry because you sold me. God sent me ahead of you to save lives. And he continues, doubles down. He says, there's a famine. The famine's going to continue. And God sent me ahead of you to ensure your survival, to save your lives. Now, his little speech here is remarkable for so many reasons. First, it shows his restraint. He could be forgiven. We would understand if he was still holding quite a bit of a grudge against his brothers. Yes, he's the ruler of the land now, and he has been for the prior 9 years. And it is good to be the king. But what about the first 13 years in Egypt when he was a slave to the chief executioner, having to fend off his master's wife's amorous, adulterous advances every day? And then after she frames him for a crime he doesn't commit, years and years in an Egyptian dungeon with no Netflix. I don't even know if they had a gym. Would have been quite understandable if he was still hot under the collar with respect to what the brothers did to him. But he's not. His restraint's remarkable. There's more. It shows his incredible belief in God, that everything comes from God. It wasn't them, it was God. And most importantly, this handful of passages is a guidebook for us. It's the playbook for what to do when someone else hurts you or embarrasses you. Think about the following hypothetical. Imagine you've got a person walking down the street. They trip, they fall, they break their leg. It's obvious they're going to need surgery. It's horrible. They look at the sidewalk. There's no defect. They tripped over their own feet. If that person's God-fearing, if they've got God on the brain, a lot or even a little bit, maybe they'll think, why did God do this? He's my loving Father in heaven. Was it a wake-up call? Was it a consequence for something I did? What lesson can I draw from this? But imagine that same person, if they looked at the sidewalk, had seen a crack. Ah, that's why I fell. What would they do? They wouldn't be thinking about God, in all likelihood. They're going to call me to see if I can sue somebody for negligence. What about case 3 in my hypothetical? Same person, except this time while they're walking down the street, they get shoved from behind by somebody and they break their leg and they're going to need surgery. They're not thinking about God. They're thinking about how to best serve up a nice, cold, violent dish of revenge against the guy that pushed them. And instead, Yosef is telling us, shouting at us from the passages in the Torah, no. Because case 3 is no different than case 2, and it's no different than case 1. Case 1 was God, case 2 was God, and case 3 was God. Somebody hurts you, somebody embarrasses you, yes, they've got an issue. They're going to have to repent sincerely in order to gain favor again with God, to get atonement from him. And that's not enough. They're going to have to appease you. They're going to have to come to you and ask for and hope to get your forgiveness. But with respect to you, your mind should not be filled with thoughts of revenge. Your mind should be thinking of, why did my loving Father in heaven, who loves me more than anyone in the world, do this? Wake up call, consequence. How can I improve my ways? What lesson can I take from this? And in fact, one of the commentators says that this is one of the reasons why the Torah prohibits revenge. Because when you plot and take revenge, you're basically telling God, excuse me, I don't need you. God, you're not part of this. This is just between me and the guy that slugged me or the guy who embarrassed me. And God's saying, actually, it's between me and you because this came from me. Yes, it came from that person. He's got his issues and he's got to deal with them. But that's not your issue. Your issue is I did this and I did it for a reason. And I love you and I still did this. Think about it. That's how we have to occupy our minds when we're wronged at the hands of others. What a beautiful guidebook. It's not easy, but we've got it right here. Here's the playbook. Here's what to think about the next time somebody does you wrong.